Friends, we have already discussed about the legal framework of the water governance and water policy. Today we will go through substance of national water laws. So why is a national law on water is necessary? There are several reasons. So under the Constitution of India, water is treated primarily as a state subject. But it is increasingly important national concern. Even though it is a state subject, the importance of water is at national level, and there is a national level concern about the following: the judicial recognition of the right to water as a part of a fundamental right to life. So the judiciary has recognized the right to water as a fundamental right. The general perception of an imminent water crisis. So there is a perception that we are going to face an water crisis, and there is a dire need and urgent to conserve this scarce and precious resource. The severe and intractable inter-uses. So there are intractable uses which may lead to interstate conflicts, and we are polluting the rivers and other water sources, turning them into sewers rather than a fresh water source, and we are contaminating even the aquifers, that is the groundwater. The long-term environmental, ecological and social implication of projects to augment the availability of water for human use. The long-term environmental, ecological and social impacts of the projects to augment the availability of the water for human use. The equity implication of the distribution, use and control of water. So there is the implications on the distribution also. We need to distribute the water equally to the all sector of the people, and we have to control the use of water for this purpose. The internal dimensions of some of India, the internal dimensions of some India's rivers. So there are some problems with the Indian rivers also. There are the internal dimensions, and the emerging concern about the impact of climate change on water and the need for appropriate responses at local, national, regional and global levels. So there is a concern, an emerging concern about the impact of the climate change, which is going to have its impact on water resource, and there is a need for appropriate responses at all the levels, that is at local level, national level, regional level and global levels. It is clear that the above consideration cast several responsibilities on central government apart from those of the state governments. So even though water is a subject of state governments, but the above considerations have led to several responsibilities on the central government too. Given these and other concerns, the need for an overreaching national water law is self-evident. So, because of these concerns, there is a need for formation of a national water law or national water policy. Several states are enacting laws on water and related issues. These can be quite divergent in their perception of and approaches to water. Some divergence from state to state may be inevitable and acceptable, but extreme and fundamental divergence will create a very muddled situation. So many states have already enacted the laws related to water and water-related issues, but there is a divergence in the formation of the framework for laws because of the different perceptions and different approaches towards water resources in their states. But some of the divergence from state to state may be inevitable, and they can be acceptable because they are the necessity of that particular region. But the extreme and fundamental divergence will create a situation which is a muddled situation. A broad national consensus on certain basis seems very desirable. Therefore, it requires a national consensus. Different state governments tend to adopt different legal positions on their rights over the waters of a river basin that straddles more than one state. So if a river flows in more than one state, so different state may tend to adopt different legal positions on rights over the water, particularly which flows in their part of the state. Such legal divergence tend to render the resolution of interstate river water conflicts extremely difficult. So such divergences tend to create the interstate water conflicts. A national statement of the general legal position and principles that should govern such cases seems desirable. So in such conditions, there should be a national statement of the general legal position. So there should be a common legal position binding all the states when such cases arise. So another reason is water is one of the most basic requirements for life. If national laws are considered necessary on subjects such as environment, forest, wildlife, biological diversity, a national law on water is even more necessary. Water is as basic as those subjects. See, already we have national laws on the aspects like environment, forest, wildlife, biological diversity, etc. So the laws on water is also necessary because water is as basic as these subjects on which already the laws have been formulated. So there is a necessity to form a national level policy on the subject of water resources. Finally, the idea of a national water is not something unusual and unprecedented. So finally, the idea is not something which is unusual and is also unprecedented, because many countries in the world have national water laws or codes, and some of them are widely regarded as very enlightened. So many countries in the globe already have the national policies in their countries and national codes for water resources. So it is not an unusual thing. Our country also should follow the same national water policies. The consideration behind those national codes laws are relevant to India as well. So these considerations on which the national water policies have been formulated in other countries, they also hold good to India, but they are governed by the Indian constitution and with the specific needs and circumstances of our country. Legal framework in India. India lacks an umbrella framework to regulate fresh water in all its dimensions. So we lack a common platform to regulate fresh water in its all dimensions. The existing water law framework in India is characterized by the coexistence of a number of different principles, rules and acts adopted over many decades. So we have the existing laws which are framed, and they are characterized by the coexistence of number of different principles. So they are formulated based on different principles, rules and acts have been adopted for over many decades. These include common law principles and irrigation acts from the colonial period, as well as more recent regulation of water quality and the judicial recognition of a human right to water. So these principles include the judicial recognition of human right to water and the colonial and the acts from the colonial period, which gives the more or the common law which was adopted for that is irrigation acts, and the more and the recent regulations of the water quality. So the principles behind our legal framework in India are basically based on the irrigation acts and some regulations on the water quality and some acts which were followed during the colonial period. In terms of statutory development, irrigation laws constitute historically the most developed part of water law. This is in large part due to the fact that colonial government saw the promotion of large irrigation works as central to its mission. So earlier in the colonial government, the irrigation was given the most prominence. Hence, the irrigation laws constituted most part of the enactment in the water resource. So the prominence to the irrigation field also introduced a regulatory framework in the water resource field. As a result, some of the basic principles of water law applicable today in India derive from the irrigation acts. That is why most of the enactments which are derived from the basic irrigation acts. Statutory water law also includes a number of pre and post independence enactments in various areas. So statutory water laws in many states include number of pre and post independent acts which have acts in their enactment. These include laws on embankment, drinking water. That means the laws include the laws enacted for the infrastructure creation, drinking water supply, irrigation, flood management, water conservation, river water pollution, rehabilitation of the evacuees and displaced persons, that is rehabilitation, and fisheries and ferries. There are nevertheless restrictions with regard to the use of interstate rivers, but still there are some restrictions with regard to the use of interstate rivers. Further, the union is entitled to legislate on certain issues. So union government is also entitled to legislate on the certain issues. These include shipping and navigation on national waterways, as well as power to regulate the use of tidal and territorial waters. The Constitution of India also provides that the Union can legislate with regard to adjudication of interstate water disputes. So our Constitution makes provision for the Union to pass some legislation regarding interstate water disputes. In general, water law is largely state-based. So in general, the water law is a state subject. This is due to the constitutional scheme which, since the Government of India Act 1935, has in principle given power to the states to legislate in this area. So states are given the constitutional provisions to frame the acts regarding water resource in their state. The states have the exclusive power to regulate water supply, irrigation and canals, drainage, embankments, water storage, hydropower, fisheries, etc. There have also been progressive calls for changes of the law and policy framework concerning water, but there are already many calls to change the existing laws and policy framework concerning the water resource because of the following broad factors. Firstly, the water law and policy framework was for a long time the object of relatively little attention. So far, the legal framework for water resource was not given much importance. While many water-related laws were adopted over several decades, comparatively little was done to provide a broader integrated framework. So far, we adopted the water laws which are very old and decades old and which are in existence, and comparatively little was done in this field, that is to integrate the framework of the legal framework of the water resource. Secondly, the recognition that there is a water crisis in most countries of the world and that availability of and access to fresh water will be a challenge for nearly all the countries in the coming decades, and has led to a number of international initiatives. And already it is globally recognized or accepted that there is going to be a severe crisis in the availability of the fresh water, and it is going to be a challenge for nearly all the countries. So this has led the international initiatives to reform water governance laws and policy in most of the developing countries. In other words, Domestic and international factors have contributed on to ongoing water law and policy reforms. So, based on these domestic and international factors, there is an ongoing process of water law and policy reforms. The existing legal framework. The existing legal, institutional and decision-making framework for water law in India, both at the national and state level, is embodied in the following acts. So the existing legal, institutional and decision-making framework is based on the, or it is embodied by the following national level acts. Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974, Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1977, Environment Protection Act 1986, Forest Conservation Act 1980 and amended in 1988, Public Liability Insurance Act 1991, Environmental Assessment Development of Projects 1994. The Ministry of Environment and Forest is the nodal agency in the administrative structure of the central government for planning, promotion and coordination and overseeing the implementation of environment legislation and programs and regulatory functions like environmental clearances. So all the issues regarding the environmental legislation, the programs and environmental clearances, the Ministry of Environment Forest is the nodal office, is the nodal agency, and it is having the administrative structures to promote and coordinate these laws on environment. The constitutional provisions in India. The constitution defines the allocation of functions relating to water resource development between center and state governments. So the constitution defines the allocations of the functions to the center as well as state governments. Water is designated as a state subject, and central intervention to regulate the development of interstate rivers and settlement of the interstate disputes. So water is basically the state subject, and central intervention is required when there is interstate disputes of the water. The River Board Acts and the Interstate Water Dispute Acts are made under these provisions. So the River Board Acts and the Interstate Water Dispute Acts have been framed under the above provisions. The central government can also intervene in the interest of protecting the environment and forest, and under provisions regarding national planning for development. So central government can intervene in the interest of protecting the environment and forest if there is an impact on these fields, that is environment and forest, due to the use of the water or use of the water sector, then definitely the central government can intervene in this issue. Under the Constitution of India, which came into force in 1950, water is primarily a state subject. Entry 17 list 2, that is state 7th schedule of the Constitution, states water, that is to say water supplies, irrigation and canal, drainage and embankments, water storage and water power subject to the provisions of entry 56 to the list 1. So states are thus free to enact the water law and frame policies in accordance with this provision. So under the constitutional provision, states are free to enact their own water laws and frame the policies. Entry 56 list 1 union list refers to the above states. Regulation and development of interstate rivers and river valleys, to the extent to which such regulation and development under the control of the union is declared by parliament by law to be expedient in public interest. So the central government can intervene in the interstate rivers and river valley projects or water resources in the interest of the public. Under Article 26 224 of the Constitution, Parliament may by law provide for the adjudication of any dispute or complaint with respect to the use, distribution or control of the water of or in any interstate river or river valleys. Neither the Supreme Court or any other court shall exercise jurisdiction in respect of any dispute or complaint referred to in one. So the Constitution gives the power to adjudication on any dispute arises due to the interstate or interstate river valleys. So Constitution has made a provision to intervention of the union in such cases. Groundwater laws. The existing groundwater law in India is close to inappropriate. This is of major significance as the use of groundwater determines the availability of water for tanks, wells and many other minor irrigation systems. We know that groundwater is available for the tanks as well as the wells and for minor irrigation systems, but the existing laws for groundwater in India are very inappropriate. Traditionally, groundwater has been treated as a chattel to land property where the access is to private landowners alone. So for traditionally, it has been treated that the water available in the private property is the property of the owner itself. Such property laws do not relate to hydrological, ecological and equity concerns at all. So the property law which is applicable to groundwater is not inconsistent with hydrological, ecological or equity concerns. The need for conjunctive use and integration of groundwater and surface water laws have also been conveniently ignored by the state government. So far, the state governments have not taken into account the conjunctive use of water, that is the integration of the groundwater and surface water laws has not been done so far, or it is conveniently ignored. There is an urgent need to systematically explore the legal alternatives for integrated set of laws that will incorporate both ecological and social diversity as well as problems related to the interrelationship between groundwater and surface water use. So there is an urgent need to explore the alternatives or the set of integrated laws for both groundwater and surface water. Existing legal framework for groundwater is as follows. Groundwater rights are under totally private legal regime. So far, the groundwater is under the private legal regime. The rights belong to the landowner since it forms part of the dominant heritage, and land ownership is governed by the tenancy laws of the state. So far it is treated that the landowner has got all the right over the groundwater available in his property. The Transfer of Property Act necessitates the transfer of groundwater based on heritage. So when the property is transferred, then the transfer of groundwater is also done along with the transfer of property, as it is treated as the heritage of the ownership. Conversely, the Land Acquisition Act asserts that if someone who were interested in getting rights over easement, he would have to possess land. There is no limit to the value of groundwater a landowner may draw. So, since it is treated as a private property, the groundwater is treated as a private property of the landowner, there is no limit for drawing the water, groundwater. It is at his will and wish, so he can extract any amount of or any volume of groundwater. The consequences of such a legal framework is that only landowners can own groundwater in India. So this has resulted into that only those who hold the property or who own the land are having the right to extract the groundwater. It leaves all landless and tribals who may have group or community rights over land but not private ownership. So this causes that those who are landless and tribals, they do not have the rights over the ownership of the groundwater. So it also implies that rich landlords can be water lords and indulge in openly selling as much water as they wish. So the landlords are not only lords for the land they are owning, but also they are water lords, and they can indulge in selling the water as per their wishes. So the following recommendations are proposed to ensure proper and equitable distribution of water. It is recommended that water rights should be separated from land rights. So to have an equitable distribution, the water rights should be separated from the land rights. No national effort has been taken so far. The only state to move in this direction is state of Gujarat. Areas where legal sanction is needed, where there is over-exploitation of groundwater, so there needs to be some legal sanctions for over-exploitation of groundwater in the private property. Where there is dispute between two parties regarding the exploitation of water, where there is environmental degradation due to over-exploitation, so there needs to be some sanctions if there is an impact due to the over-exploitation on the environment or it leads to environmental degradation. Where there is groundwater pollution, and also sanctions are needed to avoid the groundwater pollution. So, tank water bodies. In many parts of India, irrigation has traditionally been tank-based. 64% of agriculture land is rain-fed, groundwater irrigated, and natural or artificial tank irrigated crop lands. So in many parts of India, the tanks are the traditional source of irrigation, and almost 64% of the agricultural land is fed by either rain or groundwater irrigation or natural or artificial tanks. Despite this crucial dependence on tanks and wells, India has witnessed the destruction, negligence and reclamation of thousands of tanks and gross misuse of groundwater. So in spite of this, we have neglected the tanks and their use, and almost we have destructed them. So the negligence and reclamation of thousands of tanks and gross misuse of the groundwater. So this has led to the misuse of groundwater. Tank irrigation offers a vast potential for alternative approach to water management, needs to be emphasized and need to complement canal irrigation. So the tank irrigation can supplement the canal irrigation system if it is used properly. So we should have, and the tank irrigation as a potential as an alternative approach for the water management. There is need to reform the appropriate legal structure that will support local controls and provide incentives for sustainable and equitable use of water tanks. So now there is a need to provide some incentives for the sustainable and equitable use of the water tanks, and needs to have an appropriate legal structure which supports the local controls over the tanks. Tanks are local water resources. People have immediate access to them and are not dependent on far-off authorities for their water supply. So the tanks are the localized system, and people have an easy access to the tanks and their management. They need not depend on the authorities who are far off, like in other irrigation systems. So irrigation system and water supply systems. The existence of the tanks implies decentralization of power over water resources. So the existence of the tanks or the use of the tank system leads to decentralization of the powers over the water resources, because they are the localized systems where the local people can manage them properly. If we are to follow constitutional mandate of economy and social justice, it is extremely important to utilize resource in a manner which leads to equity and freedom from dependency on others. So according to the constitutional mandates, we should have the economy as well as social justice
and it is important to utilize the resource in a manner which leads to equity. Recommendations. It is proposed to make detailed study of customary and statutory laws of the concerning use of tank and wetland waters in rural areas. So there is a need to study the customary and statutory laws which govern the tank and its management as well as the wetland waters in the rural areas. It is known that these laws provide various strategies through which common resources could be utilized for common ground. The aim of the study would be to devise appropriate legal strategies for the preservation of tanks, its management, and for equitable use of its resources. So there is a need to study the various strategies through which the resource can be used in a better manner for a common good, and it can be used as a common good, and also the study should aim at devising an appropriate legal strategy for the preservation of tanks and its management. Construction of dams. So the neglect of tank and groundwater law is directly related to the emphasis on construction of dams, since these have been conceived as the main scientific alternative for irrigation and food production. Since we have neglected the use of tank and groundwater and also framing the laws for tank and groundwater use, there is a general perception that the big dams, the construction of big dams is an alternative, as a scientific alternative for irrigation and food production, and emphasis given and much emphasis is given on the construction of such dams. So, unless the appropriate legal framework is conceived for planning and establishment of dams, it is unlikely that the attentions will turn to development of tank and groundwater laws. So, unless we have some legal frameworks, stringent legal frameworks on the planning and establishment of dams, it is more unlikely that our attention will turn towards the groundwater use and framing of the groundwater laws. Construction of large dams related as booms of development in the first two decades after independence have now become the reason of unfavorable question both in official and popular discourse. So earlier, after independence, in the first two decades we thought that we pursued that construction of dam leads to the development, but as the lapse of time, now we are feeling that these have raised the unfavorable questions both in official as well as in the popular and the popular discourse. It is clear from these trends that jurisdictions and legal knowledge is yet to be related to it. The legislation includes in this area, but not substantially, to ensure just and fair and accountable use of imperious executive discretion. In all of this, the constitutional context is altogether urgent. Even though there is legislation includes in the construction of dams and use of groundwater, it doesn't ensure the just and fair intervention. So the constitution, in this the constitutional context is almost absent, or it has not given much attention towards such issues. So recommendations. Review of the emerging constitutional standards and fairness and public accountability in their bearing upon irrigation works should be conducted. So there is a need to review the constitutional provisions and standards of fairness and public accountability in the irrigation and large and medium scale irrigation projects. So critical examination of the international economic law in terms of its bearing on international human rights in the context of large and medium irrigation works in India. So based on the international economic laws and their bearing on the human rights at the international level, there is a need to study our constitutional provisions in the context of large and medium irrigation works in India. Impact of forest law and emerging environment law on dam construction. So the construction of dam are to be used in the pursuance of the emerging environment and forest loss. There is need to analyzing the constitutionally of cost benefits analysis in the determination of environment impact. So there is a need to analyze the constitutionality of a cost benefit analysis in the determination of impact assessment. Innovative exercising in safeguarding human rights in public projects is strongly recommended. So it is strongly recommended that you must exercise some innovative methods in safeguarding human rights in public projects. Okay, thank you.